There's a race of people that most around the world have probably never heard of, yet are without a doubt the single most genetically and linguistically disparate human population that has ever existed, even more so than the Andamanese, who have been isolated from all other human populations on their island chain for tens of thousands of years, or the Yaghan of Tierra del Fuego, who are the most geographically isolated people on Earth, being the closest people group to Antarctica. While looking at the differences between European, African, Oceanian, Amerindian, and Asian populations, we often forget that there could technically be considered a sixth regionalized ancestral continuum, as being the birthplace of modern humans, Africa has the largest genetic diversity of any continent, with there being a very distinct genetic strain or race found here that is quite different from the typical black African, and they're actually still around to this day. I've actually discussed this many times in the past, how there are many very physically distinct African populations, some of which can be easily identifiable, such as Horn Africans, with most Ethiopians, Somalis, and Eritreans have more quote-unquote Caucasoid features due to admixture with ancient migrants from the Middle East, and perhaps most famously, the Nilotic peoples of South Sudan, Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania are also quite easily recognizable, as I discussed in my most popular video, being the darkest, thinnest, and perhaps tallest people on Earth. However, the one group that I've somewhat glossed over in the past would be the indigenous Southern African traditional hunter-gatherers, a loose collection of peoples that more or less stem from a common gene pool dating back 1/10 of a million years ago, sometimes referred to as capoids due to their concentration near the Cape of Good Hope. These people are believed to have been descended from one of the first branches to split from modern Homo sapiens, roughly 80 to 120,000 years ago. And for context, Neanderthals and Denisovans, although considered separate species from Homo sapiens, split around 400,000 to 800,000 years ago, and Africans and Eurasians, as in all non-African populations, only split from each other roughly 50 to 70,000 years ago. Oh, and in case you're wondering why the time estimates have such huge discrepancies, it's because various sources give entirely different answers, so it's really more of a rough guess for now. This doesn't mean there wasn't significant contact between these hunter-gatherers and other Africans in that time, but they have, without a doubt, the most distinct and ancient ancestral strain, having inhabited South, Central, and East Africa for tens of thousands of years, before the much more recent migrations from the Northwest intermixed with and displaced these people groups. So think of them as the Native Americans of Sub-Saharan Africa. This is further complicated by the discovery of admixture in these hunter-gatherers that is thought to be from an entirely separate lineage from Homo sapiens altogether, with this admixture coming from a very ancient, extinct, archaic hominid found in Central Africa, with this species believed to have split from Homo heidelbergensis, the ancestors of humans, Neanderthals, and Denisovans, 700,000 to possibly even 1 million years ago, making it the most genetically disparate hominid population to ever intermix with modern Homo sapiens. As you could probably tell from the title and thumbnail, the modern descendants of this highly unique sub-Saharan population are found predominantly in the Khoisan of Southern Africa, a group that is indigenous to what is now modern-day South Africa, Namibia, Botswana, and possibly further, such as parts of Angola, Zambia, and Zimbabwe. Full-blooded Khoisan have a strikingly distinct appearance when compared to other sub-Saharan Africans, generally having lighter skin, tighter, coarser hair, and very distinguished facial features, smaller eyes, higher cheekbones, and smaller noses, somewhat reminiscent of East Asian populations. The other traditional hunter-gatherer population of sub-Saharan Africa would be the Pygmies, a group further north in Central Africa, and is closer to other African populations than the Khoisan are, but are still very genetically distinct, as we'll get to later. The Khoisan and the Pygmies were gradually pushed back by waves of migration from West Africa, some of which would give rise to the Nilotic and Afro-Asiatic populations in the east, but by far the biggest impact on these groups was the expansion of the Niger-Congo-speaking Bantu populations, originally from West Africa, in a nearly 2,000-year-long conflict known as the Bantu Expansion, wherein various tribes and clans from what is now Cameroon expanded into Pygmy, Khoisan, and Nilo-Saharan territory, intermixing with, killing, or displacing these people. As a result, the Pygmies were relegated to small pockets within the interior of the Congo, although cultural contact with the Bantus had resulted in them losing their original language, although parts of their vocabulary and grammar clearly indicate their pre-Bantu origins. The Khoisan were mostly spared due to the fact that a large part of their population lived in the Kalahari Desert of Namibia, which even today is the second least densely populated region of Africa after the Sahara, although the Khoisan became quite well adapted to this environment, learning how to hunt and forage in this desolate landscape. However, it's important to realize that the Khoisan are not exactly one people group, as although they do share many similarities and are generally grouped together for convenience sake, there are still many genetic, linguistic, and cultural differences between them. Seeing how, even though Khoisan groups share the commonality of all using click consonants, not generally seen in other languages, they are still distinct enough to be split into multiple families. Likewise, even though they all descend from the same distinct genetic lineage stretching back 100,000 years, there has been relatively little intermixing between some groups, which has led to there being more genetic distance between select Khoisan groups than between the average European or Asian. Interestingly, it's also been found that within the last couple thousand years, there was a small migrant group from somewhere around the Horn of Africa that introduced minor levels of Horn African admixture into select Khoi populations, as evidenced by the presence of haplogroup E3b in some Khoi, mostly found in many Afroasiatic-speaking peoples, although overall, most Khoisan, along with the Pygmies, belong to haplogroup A or B, as opposed to E1 or E3a, which is found in most Niger-Congo-speaking populations of West, Central, East, and Southern Africa. Because of their isolation, mostly living in the deserts and plains of Southern Africa, the Khoisan were not discovered by Europeans for quite some time, although it is true that both Western Europeans and the Bantus started to arrive in the Cape of Good Hope area around the same time, mid-1600s, and the European settlers, namely the Dutch, immediately recognized them as distinct from the neighboring Bantu peoples. Although capoid admixture in most Bantu populations is quite low, there has been considerable genetic and cultural exchange between the Khoisan and a few Bantu peoples of Southern Africa, namely the Xhosa or Khoisa and the Tswana, both of which actually contain some of the click consonants borrowed from the Khoi languages, although the Bantu speakers with the highest percentage of Khoi ancestry would be the Kigaligadi of southwest Botswana at nearly one-third of their genome. Conversely, the Khoi-speaking population with the lowest levels of capoid admixture would be the Damara of northern Namibia, who, despite speaking a language very similar to that of the nearby Nama, are actually very genetically disparate, showing almost no genetic affinity to either Khoi-speaking groups, suggesting that they are indeed Bantus who shifted to speaking a Khoi language. The Dutch, and to a lesser extent British settlers who arrived in the Cape, intermixed with the Khoi, as well as neighboring Bantu populations, and imported slaves from Madagascar, Indonesia, and India, creating a unique mixed-race population known as the Cape Coloureds that is highly heterogeneous, meaning some individuals may be mostly European, others mostly Bantu, and others mostly Khoi, with their ancestry being a spectrum depending on the individual and their geographic location. The Coloureds have evolved into a Christian, Afrikaner-speaking ethnic group that today contains some of the most diverse ancestries of any people group from around the world. Khoisan admixture in the Coloureds varies considerably, generally being highest in the Northern Cape, while another Afrikaner-speaking mixed-race group, the Basters, also exist in central Namibia as a result of Dutch explorers settling down and intermixing with native Khoi women, having quite possibly the highest Khoisan admixture of any non-Khoisan-speaking population. Capoid admixture can be found in many groups across Africa, even those such as the Afrikaners, descendants of the original white settlers of South Africa, and although found in trace amounts in virtually all African populations south of the equator, this capoid admixture is completely absent from West African populations, showing the expansion from the northwest to the south, and not the other way around. There are other traditional hunter-gatherer peoples throughout Africa, such as the Sandawe and Hadza of East Africa and Tanzania, both speaking non-Niger-Congo languages with click consonants, believed to have predated the arrival of the Bantus by many thousands of years. Sandawe oral traditions even claim to have some affinity with the population much further south, implied to be the Khoi, and you can see a very slight resemblance to the Khoisan when looking at some Sandawe individuals, as around 10-15% of their gene pool is derived from the Khoisan, While over the generations, there has been intermixing with many other neighboring populations, including the Nilotes, Kushites, and Bantus who arrived later on. However, the same can't really be said for the Hadza, and this is due to the fact that it would appear that the Hadza are more closely related to Mbudi pygmy groups from the Congo than to either the Sandawe or Khoi. The Pygmies, although a separate branch of the Southern African hunter-gatherers, are the closest race of people to the Khoisan, and for whatever reason, the Congolese Pygmies ended up evolving to become quite small in stature, and extensive studies have concluded that this adaptation is indeed genetically based, and not tied to traditional metrics of determining growth, such as nutrition or diet. Although full-blooded Khoisan, or Bushmen as they are often referred to, are becoming increasingly rare in South Africa, numbering only a few tens of thousands, they are still very much a vibrant and growing community in neighboring Botswana, and especially Namibia, where Khoisan descendants make up almost 10% of the country, and even more when considering partial descendants, while in Botswana they make up around 3% of the country, not a particularly large percentage, but they do make up a majority in the bulk of the country's land area, lying in the sparsely populated Kalahari Desert. Although their numbers may seem quite insignificant today, numbering only around 500,000, the number of Coloureds, Xhosa, Tswana, and others with Khoi ancestry are increasingly embracing their significant Khoi heritage and their contributions to their language, culture, and genes. Overall, the contribution of the Kapoids, or indigenous Southern African hunter-gatherers, isn't too high, about 1.4% of the entire genome of Africa, and only 0.24% of the entire genome of Earth, so not exactly the biggest impact on the human race, genetically speaking, but they still remain one of the most fascinating and ancient ancestral groups. So go ahead and let me know your thoughts on the Khoisan and other related groups, and for today's poll, let me know which group with ancestry from these peoples you'd like to learn more about. And as always, thanks for watching, everyone. This has been Mason. I'll see you next time.